Our God and our Father, we thank you because of the great opportunity you have given us, not only to know you as Savior, but to serve you as your servant and as your ministers. We thank you because you've made us to understand the gospel and the very fact that if anyone comes into this world and lives all through his life and does not know Jesus Christ as Savior, that person will suffer eternally. And you used other people to bring the gospel to us. So, Father, we are praying at this time of our own opportunity that you will use us to take the gospel to other people in Jesus' name. We pray that you give us the mind of Christ, burden for souls, and give us the heart that will reach out without allowing any difficulty to draw us back, so that we'll fulfill your will on earth in Jesus' name. As we open the pages of the scripture tonight again, we pray that you'll speak to us individually in Jesus' name. And we pray that your power will work within us and work through us in other people, so that we'll not just be receivers of your blessings, but we'll be channels of your blessings to other people. Use us mightily in your own way. In Jesus' name we pray. Tonight I'm talking on the reasons for our poverty. We need to consider something like that. The reasons for our poverty. As we look at the Bible, from the Old Testament to the New Testament, you are faced with a multitude of promises that God has made to his own children. There are general promises that we as workers have with other people. There are a lot of promises in the Bible that are made to all believers. And we who are workers in the vineyard of the Lord, we are also believers. And so we have those general promises to be ours. But not only that, we have some special promises that are made only to those who serve in the sanctuary. Those who serve the Lord very closely, very intimately. They give their time, they give their attention, they give their service, they give their ministry totally to the Lord. We have some promises that are given to us. And in the face of all these promises that are made to the children of God, and then to the ministers of the gospel, there is no reason at all why we should remain in need, in poverty, in lack, in spiritual stagnation. And yet, we discover amidst us, and here we are tonight, that if we look around, there are people that have biting needs in their lives. The question is, has God become unfaithful? The answer is no. Does that mean that he can no more fulfill his promises to his own children and to his own servants? The answer is no. Does it mean that our God has changed? He is not as faithful as he was at the time of Abraham, at the time of Isaac and Jacob? He doesn't mind fulfilling his promises today as he did to the children of Israel and to the Levites. You know, God has not changed. Now that we're having recession or this problem in the country, it's not a reason for us to be in need. Because in Bible days, the nation of Israel went through many situations and circumstances, and yet God in heaven provided for his own people. And I believe that if we read our Bibles aright and we do what the Lord wants us to do today, God shall be prospering and blessing his own people. And I'm believing God that we'll get out of all these difficulties and all these problems in Jesus' name. Only that you need to discover the key, and you need to discover the reasons why we are where we are, spiritually, materially, physically. You know, sometimes we have workers were sick, and God has promised healing, not only for the ordinary people, the ordinary believers, He has also promised healing and strength, health, vitality to the people that are serving him. What examples do we have in the Bible? Was Moses an invalid? Was Elijah an invalid? Not able to do what he ought to do? Paul, Peter, James, John, were they so sick they were not able to do the work of the Lord? Were they so hungry they had to be begging for bread? Were they so much in need they had to depend upon unbelievers to sustain them? Even in the time of famine, didn't God provide for people like Elijah, like Elisha, and all the other people you can mention in Bible days? Why then are we like we are? That's why we're here tonight. We'll find out reasons for our poverty. Look at the promises of God to start with. Exodus chapter 23, from verse 25. And ye shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless thy bread and thy water, and I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. When God gives me a promise, I don't like any interpreter telling me yes, but no. When God gives me a promise, I don't want any theologian coming to me and telling me, oh yes, he said so, but no. I believe that God meant what he said, and he said exactly what he meant. If he wasn't going to do it, he will not give out the promise. He is not going to tease us. He is not going to just give us a promise that is not ready to fulfill. And he told the children of Israel and said, you'll serve the Lord your God, and then he will bless your bread and your water, and then he will take sickness away from the midst of thee. Verse 26, there shall nothing cast their young, nor be barren in thy land. The number of thy days I will fulfill. Let me tell you what they do in some other churches. If they read a promise of God, and they see that that promise is not being fulfilled in the life of a worker, a minister, a preacher, a pastor, a teacher in that church, they never mention that promise again. You know why? They feel if we mention that promise of the Lord, people will begin to question, but how about so and so? How about so and so? How about so and so? Because of that, they are silent on the promises of the Lord. Oh, they say, we cannot touch that area because if we touch that area, so and so will be affected. Are we to be silent on the word of God because so and so has not been able to claim the promise of God? You know, it's the same thing with what they do concerning living right. If the preacher is living in a particular besetting sin, his marriage, a second wife, a third wife, you can be sure the preachers in that church, they never talk about holiness. They never want to talk about anything that will touch the life of any of their ministers. They are silent. If that preacher says that he has this peculiar weakness of drinking, that's not weakness, that's sin. Or they have this peculiar weakness of smoking, that's not weakness, that's sin. But in their own language, if one of their preachers, one of their ministers, has this peculiar problem of sinning, a besetting sin, you know what all the preachers in that denomination will do? They never want to read the Bible concerning that area. Or if we read the Bible concerning that area, it will affect so and so. It will affect such and such. But we are not like that. We like to be sincere with the promises of God, the commandments of God. If the Bible says so, then it is so. He meant what he said. He said what he meant. Well, then what do I do? I need to find out what's the reason for my barrenness, my poverty, my sickness, my weakness, my lack, my joblessness. I'm a child of God. I'm a worker in the vineyard of the Lord. What's the reason? Why am I like this? If I find out the reason, then I know how to solve the problem. What does the doctor do? When patients go to the doctors, the doctors say, no, I don't like to investigate. I do not like to carry out any diagnosis because it might embarrass the patient. How then will you treat that patient? You know what they do? They diagnose, they find out, they examine. And they do not think they're embarrassing you when they tell you this is the reason for your problem. If those doctors were that sincere, why are preachers not sincere? Why are we covering up? Why are we not telling the truth? It says, and there shall nothing cast their young, nor be barren in thy land. The number of thy days I will fulfill. Then if I have that problem, I need to be checking up. Why? Why am I like that? Why am I this way? I want you to look at Psalm 37. Psalm 37 from verse 25. I have been young, now I'm old. I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. David was giving a testimony. He's saying, I don't know what others have observed, what they have seen. Here is what I have seen, what I have known, what I have experienced. He said, I have been young, now I am old. That spans a period of many years. He says, I'm not young anymore, now I am old. And I've been observing this since I was young. I have not seen the righteous forsaken. And you can look around in your own zone. And you can ask yourself, you have been young, you are growing up, you are not old yet. But have you not seen, apparently, it appears, those people that are righteous, it appears they are forsaken. We have seen them begging for bread. And I'm here to tell you, it ought not to be so. It ought not to be so. If it is so, what's the reason? That's why we are here. The reason is for our poverty. I don't believe the reason is because God doesn't care anymore. He's still caring. He says, I am God, I change not. We're not begging because Jesus is not able to provide anymore. You know what he did when he had his ministry here on earth? He fed 5,000 men. Without counting the children and without counting the women, he fed them on 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, 2 pieces of fish. And we're told in the Bible, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. If he remains the same, he can do what he did those days. Do you believe that? You know what we should do? We should never give excuse for any problem that we have. Because that will just be the same. Like those people in those other places, those denominations, that will give excuse for their sinning. Oh, they will say they can never stop sinning. They'll never be sinning every day, every time, every moment. They can never live the victorious life. And they give a lot of excuses. But the Bible doesn't allow us any excuse to live in sin. The same thing. The Bible doesn't allow us any excuse to live in poverty, in need, in lack. Look at Psalm 35, verse 27. Let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. Yea, let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified, which has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. Now, this is peculiar to the servant of the Lord. And if you're an ambassador of Christ, if you're a soul winner in the gospel, if you're a worker in the ministry, if you're serving the Lord, then you're a servant of the Lord. You know what the Bible says? Let them say continually. You know what that means? From generation to generation. Let there be no generation of believers, of servants, of workers in the vineyard, that will say, God is no more interested in the prosperity of the workers. But let them say continually. Let them say from generation to generation. Let them say in every age, every period, that the Lord be magnified, who has pleasure, delight in the prosperity of his servants. And that should make me to begin to question, if that is so, in the Old Testament, if that was so, under the Old Covenant, will the New Covenant be something less? That those of us under the New Covenant will say, yes, it's just unfortunate. We're living in the New Testament era, in the New Covenant dispensation. Shouldn't things be better under the New Covenant? Look at what Jesus said. Matthew chapter 19. From verse 27. Then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we are forsaking all and followed thee. What shall we have therefore? Here is a servant of the Lord, a minister in the gospel, a person that left all to follow the Lord. And he said, Lord, we have left all and we have followed thee. I want you to remember that Peter was a person that knew the Old Testament. Because Andrew said unto him, we have found him of whom it was written, the Messiah, in the books of Moses. Then he quoted the word. They knew the Old Testament. They knew those people under the Old Covenant dispensation. Right back from the time of Adam, how God created everything and he handed it over to Adam. They knew how God provided for the need of Noah and the family of Noah. They knew how he blessed Abraham and Lot so abundantly the land was not able to occupy them. They knew how he supplied the need of 3 million Jews in the wilderness all through the 40 years of their wandering. Didn't they know how they came to the land of Canaan and there was no lack in the midst of the people of God at that time? They knew, even though those people were not warriors, they were not trained to fight, yet they always overcame in all the battles that came against them. Wouldn't Peter and the rest of the apostles remember how the Lord provided for Elijah at a time of famine? My brother, why do you think? Because of the austerity, because of the need in the land, because of the condition in Nigeria right now, then all of us will have to die of malnutrition. I don't think so. Why do you think like that? They must have remembered how God provided for Elijah. They must have remembered at the time of Elisha, when there was a terrible biting famine, that there were 100 people. And Elisha said, set before them, let them eat. And one of the servants said, what? Shall I set this before 100 men? Will it go around? Elisha said, I said, give unto them. And the Bible record is that they all ate and it remained. They must have remembered all those people of the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. Now they said, this is the New Covenant. The Lord Jesus, the Messiah, has come. He has called us. And we were skillful fishermen, some of us, before we left everything and followed him. So, it's a point of interest. Lord, we have left all. Now we have followed thee. What shall we have therefore? Look at the answer of Jesus. Let me remind you that Jesus meant what he said, and he said what he meant. I have problem with people that will read the promises of God and then they will qualify it, modify it, edit it, take away from it, add to it, subtract from it. I like to take the words of Jesus at face value. I like to see that Jesus said what he meant. Will not the Lord of language know how to use language? If he wanted to talk plainly, didn't he know how to talk plainly? If he wanted to give an unqualified promise, didn't he know how to give unqualified promise? I believe he knew how to do it, and he did it. Look at verse 28. And Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, ye that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye shall sit upon the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone, mark that in your Bible, everyone, if you are part of the people of God, you are part of the ministers of the gospel, you are part of the servants of the Lord, you are part of the soldiers, the ambassadors of Christ, mark it in your Bible. Everyone that has forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, a mother, or wife, or children, or land, for my name's sake, shall receive an 100-fold. and shall inherit everlasting life. Oh, somebody says, oh yes, that hundredfold is by and by when the trumpet sounds, by and by when we go to heaven, by and by when we get that, when we get that. But look at Mark chapter 10. The same passage, parallel passage. Mark chapter 10, verse 28. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have left all and have followed thee. Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you. The word verily means certainly, without doubt. Nothing can shake this one. This one will stand as long as the pillars of the throne of God in heaven, as long as those pillars are standing. Anytime that Jesus said, verily, certainly, assuredly, you know, he was about to say something that is unshakable. That the economic crunch cannot shake. That the conditions in Nigeria cannot change. Verily, assuredly, I say unto you, that no man, that's another way of saying every man that has done this, that no man that has left house, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or land, for my sake, and for the gospel's sake, but he shall receive an hundredfold now in this time. Now in this time. Do you believe that? Is that for you? Will it be fulfilled? You know, the right attitude is, oh Lord, I don't know why I've missed it for the past 5 years, but from today I will claim it. I don't know why I didn't get that before, but now I've seen it, it is mine. I don't know why it escaped my attention, and my face couldn't hold it and grip it all these years, but this very night, it's going to be mine. You know, it's just like the person that has not been born again. And then he's been hearing the gospel, he's been hearing the gospel. Maybe it's your brother, or it's your neighbor, or it's just your friend. You've given him tracts, you've done everything. And one way or the other, he has missed it for the past 5 years. But one day, somebody read the word of God to him and said, now is the time of salvation. Now is the accepted time. And he wakes up all of a sudden and he says, I don't know why I've missed it for the past 5 years, but now it is mine. Now it is mine. Now it is mine. It's just like somebody who has been sick for a long time. And the Bible, he has been hearing the word of God, by his stripes we're healed. By his stripes we're healed. He remained sick. But one day, all of a sudden, it dawned on him, by his stripes we are healed. And he wakes up and he says, why have I missed it all along? Why have I not claimed it all along? Now it is mine. Now it is mine. That's exactly the same thing you have to do. Instead of regretting, instead of crying, instead of looking back, instead of saying, I don't know why I've missed it. I don't know why I'm still poor. I don't know why I'm still in need. I don't know why I'm in this problem. Instead of looking back and saying, I don't know why I've missed it all along. Now, just wake up and claim it. That Jesus said, but he shall receive an hundredfold now in this time. Houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the world to come eternal life. Listen to me. If you look at that verse 30, almost every one of us can raise up our hands. If I ask you, how many of you have claimed the last part of the verse? The persecution, the suffering, the reproach. That we have a lot of testimonies from that area. Well, I've not got the houses, but thank God I've got the persecution. I've not got the lands, but thank God I've got the persecution. I've not got the brethren. You know, nobody cares for me. No mother in the gospel, no father, no wife, no children, no sister. Nobody will even think that I'm suffering and take care of me. I don't know why everybody in the church forsakes me, but, well, I have more than my share of the persecution. Why are you claiming only the persecution and you leave all the other things? Why are we like that? Why are we like that? Why are people saying in the church, I'm a child of God, I'm a worker in the church, I don't even have any friend. Why? Nobody loves me. Why? Look at all this. He says, you will gain brethren and sisters and mothers and children. If Jesus was telling the truth, and I believe Jesus was telling the truth, because his truth personified, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. And he never said anything that was false. If he meant what he said, if he said what he meant, why? Nobody to care for you in the gospel. And you see many people that are packing away, and they are saying, well, nobody cares for me. Something is wrong somewhere. You don't ask somebody. You say, I feel like an orphan. Why? You are a child of God. Why should you feel like an orphan? No father, no mother, no child, no sister, no brother. We must reclaim all the things we have lost. All the things that we have been cheating ourselves with. I don't think this is even the devil alone now. I think this is just plain ignorance on our part. That we have not known the promises of God. We have not known what Christ has given out to his own servants, to his own children. But tonight we know it. And we're going to stand upon the promises of God. We're going to claim the promises of God. And in a few years' time, we will be able to testify like David of old. I have been young, now I am old. I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. We're not going to beg for bread. God is going to provide, and he's going to meet all our needs. And he says, in the world to come, life eternal. You know the people that will tell us that our reward is in heaven. When you are hungry, in need, no money, no food, you're naked, and you're having the cold. Somebody that doesn't know the Bible, he thinks he knows the Bible. He thinks he's a child of God. He thinks he's a counselor. He'll come to you and say, don't worry about it. After all, our reward is in heaven. Over here, we're supposed to remain hungry. Over here, we're supposed to remain in suffering and sickness. They think they're counseling. But you know what Job said? Job told all those people, you're miserable counselors. I know better than that. God wants to take care of me here in this world. And I believe he wants to take care of you here in this world. Do you believe that? It will be unto you according to your faith. When you begin to see the promises of God, and you see that the Lord wants to bless me, why am I like this? He wants to heal me. Why am I like this? He wants to give me children. If I'm barren, why am I like this? Didn't he tell me whatsoever I desire? In fact, he told the ordinary run-of-the-mill Christian, the ordinary folk, the ordinary believer, that we should believe the Lord. Whatsoever you desire when you pray, believe that you have received and you will have. If he told the ordinary believers that, how about myself? How about yourself? Ministers of the gospel, workers in the vineyard. I believe the Lord is going to bless us. And this day will be a turning point in your life. It will be a turning point in our church. And among the workers tonight is going to be a turning point in Jesus' name. You see, with all these promises, we as workers and servants of the Lord, we shouldn't still remain poor, spiritually weak, unfulfilled, barren, hungry and needy. We shouldn't remain in debt. Think about it. When Jesus saw that he couldn't pay tax, he asked Peter, he said, Peter, tell me, of whom do the children of this world receive tax? Of strangers or their own children? And Peter said, of strangers. And Jesus said, then are the children free? And the answer is yes, for them in Israel. But he said, lest they should take offense. Take your hook, go to the riverside, to the bank, the river bank. And a poor fish that comes out, take it up, and open the mouth, and take the money, and then pay for yourself and myself. That Jesus Christ, can't he work miracles today? Or is it only miracles of healing that he can perform? Didn't he say, the work I do, ye shall do. Why do we remove that type of work? Now the question is, Peter, when we get to heaven, I will ask Peter, because I don't know the answer really. I will ask Peter, after you took the money, what did you do with the fish? Because if you are like the people that I know, the people who are here in deeper life, they will throw the fish back. They will say, well, the Lord only told me to take the money. Well, fish, you are free. Go back to the riverside. I'm going to ask Peter when we get to heaven. After you took the money, what did you do with the fish? I suppose that Peter will tell me that is the extra. He told me 100-fold. When I picked up the money, I remembered 100-fold and I took the fish home to my wife. But, you know, many people, they don't understand the promises of God. They say, I take that little thing, that extra thing, let me throw it back. The Lord wants to bless us. Why are we reserved? Why are we limiting our prayers? Why are we limiting our desires? Why don't we say, Lord, I know you are going to bless me. And the Lord is going to bless you. And the Lord will, you know what God said? He said, he will so bless the Gentiles, he will make the Jews jealous. He'll bless the Gentiles so much that the Jews will begin to say, those Gentiles, before they knew the Lord, they didn't have anything. Now they have known the Lord. Look at what they have. And when God blesses the Gentiles to the point he makes the Jews jealous, that's something. That's something. When God blesses you, to the point that your relatives and members of your family will be running and they will be saying, if Christianity is like that, if the gospel is like that, they become jealous. And they say, I'm going to receive the Lord. I'm missing a lot. But when other people, when you invite them to the Lord and they say, well, I will come by and by. When I'm ready to suffer like you, I'll come. When I'm ready to be naked like you, I'll come. But now, I want to fend for myself and my family. Because I see that since I became a Christian, no blessing, no food, no house, no accommodation. When I'm ready for all that, then I will come. I don't think that's good. I don't think that's good. But in the early church, they were blessed so much. Blessed so much. The Bible says there was no lack in the midst of all of them. And let me tell you, the church was growing at a fantastic rate. Thousands were coming into the kingdom of God every time. And yet, in all the thousands of the people that were coming to the Lord, yet, you know, there was no lack. We are not too many yet. God who supplied the need of millions in the wilderness. No supermarket. No bank to lend them money. No shelter under which they will take cover. And they were just going in the wilderness. That same God that provided for all those Israelites in the wilderness. Can't you do the same today? If you will challenge God and say, Lord, I want to live the days of the Bible again. I'm not happy with contemporary Christianity. I'm not happy with mediocre Christianity. I'm not happy with all the things I see around me. I'm not even happy with myself. I want greater blessings from the Lord. I've been saved. I've been sanctified and baptized in the Holy Ghost. I want all the other benefits and blessings of the Lord. And I believe that I am going to get into it. If nobody else gets it, I'm going to get it. That's what it took us before we got saved. When you had the word of salvation, what did you say? You say, even if nobody else gets it. If nobody else has got saved, now that I've seen it, I'm going to get saved. When you heard about holiness, what was your attitude? Didn't you say, Lord, holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord? If nobody else believes it, I believe it. Don't you believe holiness? Now, that's the attitude we had. We said, if nobody else is claiming it, if nobody else is enjoying it, I'm going to enjoy it. What did you do when you heard of the power of God to heal? Other people might have been doubters, but you said, I'll get it. I'll get it. I'll get into it. If nobody else gets it, I'm going to get healed. That's how you got healed. What did you do with the baptism in the Holy Ghost? With the evidence of speaking in tongues? You said, if nobody else believes it, I don't care how long it takes me. If I have to dig, if I have to pray, if I have to fast, if I have to lay all on the altar, if nobody else gets an experience like this, the total thing. Not the people that will say, well, they've got the Holy Ghost baptism, but the evidence is not there. I want the whole thing. the evidence as well with it. That's how you got it. The same thing with the blessings of God on prosperity. God taking care of you. Why should the believers be going around begging? I think it's an insult to Almighty God that the children of the King, the Creator of the heavens and the earth, that we will be going to the unbelievers and the sinners outside and say, can you give me 5 naira there? I think that's an insult to Almighty God. I believe that children of God should be going to Almighty God and they should be saying, oh Lord, give me enough for myself and to lend to the unbelievers. Didn't the Lord say in the Old Testament, you will not be tail, you will be head? Why are we begging? Didn't the Lord say that He will bless you so much abundantly, you will not borrow, you will be lending unto other people? I'm waiting for the time when every member in this church, every brother in this church, every sister in this church, every worker in this church will not beg anybody for anything. They will be begging you and you will be lending to them in Jesus' name. I've not finished my message, but I'll continue next time. There's always time to continue, but I want you to pray now. Claim the promises of God. Claim the promises of God. Don't let us remain in need. Don't let us remain poor. Don't let us remain sick. Don't let us remain barren. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Has God changed? Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. We're going to pray tonight. Let's all stand. Amen. As God changed, my God will never change. As God changed, my God will never change. This same yesterday, today and forever. As God changed, my God will never change. As God changed, my God will never change. As God changed, my God will never change. The same yesterday, today and forever. As God changed, my God will never change. Never change that God changed. As God changed, my God will never change. Is the same yesterday, today and forever. As God changed, my God will never change. He will never change. As God changed, as God changed, the same yesterday, today, and forever. As God changed. Amen. Amen. What promise are you looking for tonight? Claim the promises of the Lord upon your life. Claim the promises of the Lord upon your life. Amen. As we pray together tonight, let's make up our minds we're going to stand on the promises of God. God will never change. Now listen to me. Amen. If somebody is just about to get saved, we look at the promises of God and say, well, maybe I'll get saved, maybe I'll not get saved. That doubt may keep him out of the kingdom. If somebody that is praying to be sanctified will say, maybe it's real, maybe it's not real, maybe those scriptures are properly interpreted, maybe they are not properly interpreted, that may keep him outside that experience of holiness. Amen. If somebody is praying for the power of God to fall upon him, but while praying for the power of God to descend upon him, is wondering, maybe, maybe not. Probably it is still available, maybe it has passed away. Well, the last apostle, that person that night will not be able to get anything. The same thing with all the other needs of our lives. You are barren, you need children. You are poor, you need provision. You are lonely, you need the promise of God that He'll give you fathers and mothers and friends and brothers and sisters to care for you. If you are saying, maybe, maybe not, you'll be keeping yourself away from the fulfillment of the promises of God. You are sick and you need to be healed. If you are thinking, maybe, maybe not, that may keep you outside the fulfillment of the promises of the Lord for your healing and deliverance. But tonight, I believe there is no doubt in your heart. I believe that you are standing upon the promises of the Lord. Just close your eyes and bow your heads and let's pray together. Tonight we're taking authority over anything that has been a hindrance in your life. And the Lord definitely will bless your life in Jesus' name. We're children of God. We are not following the devil. We're servants of the Most High. Employees of kings and princes in this world, they are provided for. Why? Are we in the greatest work that any man ever did on the face of the earth? And yet, we're in need. God must supply the need of His own people. Father, in the name of Jesus, You have opened our eyes tonight. And Lord, we're not going to remain blind to Your promises anymore in Jesus' name. When Your word says something, that thing is real. There is no modification. We can't change Your word. Are we human beings going to teach you how to use human language? Are you not the creator of the heaven and the earth? When you gave out your promises, you said what you meant what you said. And therefore we come before you today, claiming your promises, standing upon your promises. And we know there is not a devil out of hell, there is not a demon on the face of the earth, and there is no power of darkness underneath the earth or on the earth that will stop the fulfillment of your promises for us in Jesus' name. We're going to enter into the abundance of the Lord. All the needs of our lives are going to be met. The sick, they are going to be healed. Those who have been oppressed and tormented, they are going to be delivered. Do it for every one of us in Jesus' name. Lord, I bring those who are sick among the workers before you. By the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. Those who are weak in body, infirm in their body, I bring them before you tonight, O God. And Lord, I rebuke that sickness. I rebuke that weakness. And I command that all those sicknesses vanish away in Jesus' name. the pain that has destroyed the body. Lord, I cancel everything right now. Any worker that ought to be here tonight who is not here because of sickness, Lord, we take authority over that sickness and we command that those sicknesses will vanish away in Jesus' name. For those who have just been managing to live, they're so weak, they're so sick, they don't know whether they'll still be alive tomorrow. Oh Lord, I cancel all the powers of the enemy, all the forces of darkness, all the sicknesses from the devil, and we command the devil, pack all your load and go in Jesus' name. For those who are here tonight, who are weak in their body, sick in their body, and they're not able to do what they ought to do, Lord, I pray that you will touch them, and the healing virtues of the Lord will pass through their body, and you will heal them in Jesus' name. For those who have children that are sick, wives that are sick, husbands that are sick, we bring those children and husbands and wives to the throne of mercy right now. And I pray, Lord, you'll touch them with your healing hand. You will touch them with your healing hand. You will take the infirmities and the sicknesses away in Jesus' name. Here tonight, workers, men or women that are barren, this is not what you told us. The promise that you gave us is that we'll serve the Lord our God. He'll bless our water. He'll bless our bread. He will take sickness away from the midst of us. You said, no one will be barren among us. Therefore, Lord, I bring everybody before you. Servants of the Lord, ministers of the gospel, preachers of the gospel of the kingdom, those who are serving you day and night, those who are bringing other people to the kingdom of God, those who are helping other people to know the Lord, those who are shining forth the light of the gospel. Oh Lord, we reject barrenness in their families in Jesus' name. Lord, husbands and wives that are serving you, husbands and wives that are going about all the city, all their zone, all their districts, and they're serving the Lord. They are preaching the gospel. They are bringing many people to the Lord. Oh Lord, they will not be barren. Lord, they will not be barren. Whatever needs to be touched in their bodies, touch it and give them children in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, those who are leading our fellowship, those who are helping in the area, those who are helping with the children, those who are working with the ushers, those who are working in the choir, those who are working with the students, those who are working in language halls, everyone, oh Lord, I pray, give them children in Jesus' name. Lord, we're looking out for the people that have been tormented, oppressed by the enemy, terrified by the enemy, that in the night they are afraid to sleep, in the morning they are afraid to go out. Fear is not of the Lord. That spirit of fear, I command you now, come out in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for all your children, all your servants, that from this very day, we will never be the same again in Jesus' name. I pray for your children who are in debt. Lord, we should be giving to the people of the world. But to see that we're owing landlords, to see that we're owing some neighbors and friends, Lord, Moses did not owe anybody in Egypt. Elijah did not owe Ahab or Obadiah anything at all. Neither did Elisha, that man of God, owe death or all the other people that worked for you and served you in Bible days. We do not read of the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ that they were debtors to anybody. We did not read about the deacons in the church, about the workers in the early church, that they were owing their neighbors. You provided for them. You met all their needs. And we know you have not changed. You remain ever the same.
And you told us that let the people say continually, let the Lord be magnified who has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. And this is our own time, this is our own generation. And we know you still have pleasure in the prosperity of your children and of your ministers. Therefore, Lord, I pray, as many of us here today that are owing, I pray that within a short time, you will provide for them. You will open the windows of heaven, and they will pay all their debts in Jesus' name. Lord, is it right that your own children, your own servants, your own ministers, the preachers of the gospel, they'll be withdrawing their children from school? They can't pay school fees. Lord, what do we tell our children? That we served you, we are not able to train them? What do we tell our children? That we worked for you, we are not able to send them to school? What do we tell our children? That we were following you, we were claiming your promises, we were praying unto you, we were coming to church, but we are not able to educate them? We can't tell our children that, oh Lord, we are praying, you'll provide for all the families in Jesus' name. Our children will be educated. Our children will be fed. Our children will be accommodated. Our children will be provided for. Do it for everyone in Jesus' name. Lord, there are people that are being terrified by enemies, human enemies, but we never run from anybody. The devil will have to run. The witches will have to run. The wizards will have to run. All the people that have the path of darkness, they will have to run. Therefore, Lord, we claim the fire of the Holy Ghost, the protection of the blood of Jesus Christ upon every minister of the gospel, upon every worker in this church, that, Lord, all the enemies will run from us in Jesus' name. We're praying that all that your people have told you tonight, all that we have claimed tonight, you will give to every one of us in Jesus' name. Wherever there has been family trouble because of argument about money, it is when the money is not enough we're arguing about it. It is when the food is not enough, we're arguing about it. It is when the provision is not enough, we're arguing about it. Lord, we pray, wherever there has been trouble, wherever there has been argument, we pray that you make abundant supply for them in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray your children, your people will be the head and not the tail. From now on, we shall make progress. From now on, we shall have our promotion. From now we shall have the blessings of the Lord. Bless all your people in Jesus' name. Lord, we're taking your word for it. We're believing your word for it. We're not doubters. We're believers of the word of Almighty God. And Lord, we pray that tonight, from this very evening, we'll begin to see the change. We'll begin to see the transformation. All that were presented before you tonight, Father, we pray you open the windows of heaven and you will shower your blessings upon everybody in Jesus' name. We're more than conquerors. We're inheritors of the blessings of God. Thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please remember, as we have prayed, our God is faithful. Don't wonder what happened yesterday, what happened last month. Forget last month. Forget last year. Our God is a present help in the time of trouble. If anybody is sick in your zone, as you go back tonight, Now with this anointing, just go back and lay your hands on them and get them healed. If there's any need in your life, and the children have been saying, well, we can't go to school, get ready, your children will go back to school. You've been a worker, and people have been challenging you. Yes, you are working, but you don't have this, you don't have that, and no child in the family. Tell them the children are coming. And God will never fail.